Hey, I'm Sam and I do design, and in the video today, I'm showing you how to recreate this architectural photo in Keyshot. I was scrolling through Instagram the other day when I saw this post from Instagrammer Shunkun, and they post architecture, art, and sculpture photos over on their Instagram account. And I saw this photo and I really wanted to try to recreate it in Keyshot. Now, I've done this exact same thing before by taking a photo from Instagram and recreating it. That's linked up in the top corner if you want to go and check out the first episode, but this time I want to do things slightly differently and show you the entire speedrun of my Keyshot work from start to finish. So in the previous video, I had already set up the Keyshot scene and I was just taking you through the aftermath, I guess, of that. Whereas in this video, I'm starting from a fresh blank canvas and I'm building the entire thing in Keyshot to see how close we can get just with some simple pieces of geometry. So without further ado, here we go. I've started by importing a cube and the first thing you need to do is make sure that everything you're working with is in the correct units. Okay, so I went up and changed the units to millimeters, and then based on that, I know roughly how high I need the ceiling to be, how wide the room needs to be, and that's really important to allow Keyshot to calculate everything as physically, as accurately as possible, as accurately and as physically as possible. All I've started to do then is remove one of the faces from the cube by going in and changing, separating surfaces in the Keyshot menu. And then I've gone ahead and added a sun and sky HDRI. So the HDRI is a sphere that wraps the entire model, and anything that is light in that sphere will create a light, and anything that is dark will create a shadow. So with the sun and sky HDRI, what you can actually do is set the date and time, as well as the rotation, as well as the brightness. And that was what I was using to create this effect where the highlight, the light coming through, is perfectly mirrored by some reflections coming off a lake. So this actual architectural photo itself, that comes from the modern art museum out there in Japan, and I was scrolling through this, and this is a place that I really, really want to visit now. Even just seeing this image on Instagram really makes me want to go and visit. So I can't quite do that just now, so the best I've got after that is creating it in Keyshot. And all I'm doing is adding in different materials. I'm separating out the cube and then I'm going in and adding the materials. So I think a lot of the materials that I got for this model was from Polygon, but you can get your materials from anywhere you like. And I was using displacement on this gravel texture. I know, because this is hindsight talking, but I know that I was actually displacing it backwards right now. So what's actually happening with displacement is you are changing the geometry of a flat plane and giving it extra geometry. Keyshot can read a JPEG with black and white values, and the light values are raised up and the black values are kept in the same location. And that creates this extra geometry. So in order to create the main reflection, all I had to do was add a simple plane on the ground floor. On the ground plane, I changed that to a metallic finish, so it was just a mirror, and I didn't use any roughness whatsoever. I was just using a mirrored finish to act as the lake reflection. So this whole process only took me, I think, about 1 hour to get through from start to finish. I've sped this up now by about 600 times, so we can get through this speed run super quick. But a lot of it is trial and error. I'm not gonna lie. I was just changing buttons as I went along. I didn't even know if I wanted to render in interior mode or product mode, if I needed to have caustics off and on and then composite those two images, or if I could get everything with the caustics turned on. So Keyshot actually has different modes of rendering, and that has different calculations to figure out the light and the shadow in the scene. Usually I do like to stick with interior if I'm in anything that's in an enclosed space, just like this is. But actually I find that product mode has much more natural noise textures and much more natural noise pattern when it starts to render out. And whereas interior mode can give you artifacts in the shadows that need photoshopping after the fact, product mode tends to have more of a filmic grain. So even if you have a bit of noise in the image at the end, it actually looks like you've shot the image on film, which I do quite like in this instant. So because we're using caustics, which creates light reflections in the scene, and that's what's giving us our reflection, I was really careful on how to get some clean caustics in this case. If you have too many reflections going on, like you see at the top of the image, you get these fireflies. So what I was actually doing was turning down all of the reflectivity of the rest of the materials and just leaving the reflectivity up to the mirrored finish of the pond itself. So what I've gone ahead and done here is I've cheated a little bit to create the rails that the window runs on. And all I did was I duplicated the box, the room, and changed the scale of it and the material to create this metallic finish. And then I added in a mesh pattern in the material graph and just changed that to the line setting and gave it some artificial lines that we're imagining that some glass might run through. Once I've got most of the stuff in my scene, I can start to then look at the curves and the lighting and the post-processing that I'd try to change in Keyshot as well. So this is a theme from my original video. If you went back to go and watch that just now, the chair in the empty room, is that I like to play with the levels and the curves within Keyshot itself before I take that out into Photoshop and then Lightroom after that. So all the way through, I'm still not quite happy with, I wanted to replicate pretty accurately the light position and also the reflection position as well. So I was really trying to figure out what angle that sun would need to be at and what rotation the whole HDRI would need to be as well. I didn't actually have the image on the screen that I'm trying to copy. I just had it on my phone next to me. So I was looking down every now and again and realizing that, you know, the camera's not quite aligned properly, or actually I think this was shot on an iPhone, so the depth of field would be more like a 30 millimeters and less like 100 millimeters that you might find on a DSLR or something like that. So all the time I was going through and just retweaking minute details such as that to try and get it as accurate as I could to the original image. Now what you'll also notice is that I've taken some liberties on this outside face, the outside wall next to the pond. In the original image, there's a lot more detail out there. There are some clouds in the sky, and I could have gone into a lot more detail out in the pond area, but I just decided not to. I decided the effort it would have taken me to add in those extra details for the purpose of this tutorial, for the purpose of this speedrun, wasn't worth it. So that's one thing that I would like to spend some more time on a little later. And what I also realized is that originally I had a noise fractal bump map going into this mirror effect, because I just thought that was going to be accurate enough to create the ripples, the caustics on the wall. But what I went and did after that was found some tileable bump maps and normal maps that allowed me to really recreate a realistic water effect. So I just downloaded those from the internet. Credit to those, whoever made those normal maps, but that really helped with the fidelity of the waves that I was getting. And you can see already, just as that starts to res up, that was so much more accurate than the general noise fractal map that I had in there before. At this point, I was playing two of the different normal maps off each other. So I was trying to figure out which ones I would like to use and in which combination, how strong should each of them be. I actually think that in real life, the way that Keyshot has treated these normal maps, if you look at the water naturally and look directly at it, it looks absolutely smooth. It looks like a mirrored finish. But by the time it gets into the room and by the time it's dispersed and refracted like it has, I think it's got pretty close to where the original was. So all the composition that I had to do in Photoshop after the fact was just to make another render without any caustics turned on whatsoever. And then that's when I could composite those two. And I could just make sure that any of the fireflies that we had weren't present. And then I imported that into Lightroom to do a final pass with some levels adjustments and some color adjustments. And then essentially, that's pretty much it. Now, you will notice that I changed the material of the wall. I changed the material of the ceiling. Once I sat down to start this voiceover, I looked at the two images side by side and realized I could probably get closer. So I went ahead and changed the wall and changed the lighting position ever so slightly. And that meant that I could get something that I think is really accurate to the original image. So there we have it. That's a speed run through my entire Keyshot workflow, right the way from starting the scene with a cube all the way out to Lightroom and Photoshop and post-processing. Thank you so much to Shunkun for sharing this video. And I really hope that I get to go and visit the Modern Art Museum out there in Japan. If you learned anything in this video or have some tips for me in my future Keyshot videos, do let me know down in the comments below. And don't forget to like and comment and subscribe and hit the bell button and everything else that YouTube asks you to do. And I will see you all in the next video. Bye.